This Equipment World video is brought to you by Chevron Delo 600 ADF Ultra Low Ash Diesel Engine Oil. It's time to kick some ash. Hi everybody, welcome back to Equipment World. You're watching The Dirt. I'm your host Brian, and today we're going to talk about the bane of your existence. We're going to talk about your aftertreatment system and the shocking impact that the engine oil has on that system. I'm going to tell you, this is a lengthy interview, but I would highly encourage you to watch to the end. This was an incredible education, even for myself. I got a ton out of this interview. So without further ado, here is Keith with Chevron. Thank you so much for being on the show today. I really appreciate it.
Hi, you're welcome, Brian, and glad to be here.
So aftertreatment systems are huge in our industry and the off-road industry. And so my first question is, how in the world does something that comes after the combustion process actually impact the formulation of the oil that is in the engine? How does that work?
I think we all understand, right, the aftertreatment systems that we have today or have been put in place to manage the emissions coming out, so the NOx and the particulate matter. And to get that, it's not just putting the aftertreatment system in, there's been a lot of work done to make the engines more efficient and more fuel efficient to kind of control the source of the emissions. And it's that higher brake mean effective pressure, which is basically increasing the torque per liter displacement of the engine, that is creating some issues on the lubricant, right? Because you're having higher output, smaller engines, hotter engines. And the engines are running hotter today because they're handling more horsepower per liter, if you will. But that's a good thing for the aftertreatment systems. The aftertreatment systems need the high temperatures to function. And you're talking at minimum, those aftertreatment systems need to see 500 F, and really when you're getting into DPFs and such, it's 1,000. So you're putting a lot of heat on those aftertreatment systems, right? And which translates into the engine as well. And I think for off-highway, it's a little more difficult than your fleet, your on-highway fleet. In the off-highway space, we all know you've got limited space to deal with. I mean, if you look at some of the loaders and whatnot, and you look at the engines on top of the aftertreatment system, it's amazing how they can get all of that in there. So it generates a lot of heat and a lot of load. It's really a good thing for the end user at the end of the day, because I was talking at a reliability maintenance conference a few years ago, and we were talking about the differences between, you know, engines then and engines now. And I took the example of a Cat 980 loader and, you know, a 980G and let's say a 1988 before all this emissions stuff came into play. And you were dealing with, let's say, a 15 liter Caterpillar engine that was putting out 300 horsepower. Today, that same 980 has a 13 liter engine and puts out 460 horsepower. And the difference in fuel consumption was, you know, like 9-10 gallons per hour to 5.5 to 6 gallons per hour today. So it's really a big change. And we saw on how it impacts the oil formulations and what have you. We saw, you know, API CJ4, which was really came into the market in 2007. That was an oil that was, the chemical box was restricted to reduce it to 1% ash. And it was really made to have a no harm on the aftertreatment system. How little harm can we do? Because we know that some of the components in the oil, the sulfurs, the phosphorus, and the ash content, is going to impact the aftertreatment system. So it was kind of a, let's try and minimize the harm. Well, what's happened as the engines are getting more efficient and higher horsepower, higher temps, is the industry saw, and this was API CK4, was the oils needed more oxidation control. And that was really what CK4 was about, was giving you an oil that's going to handle higher temps and try and achieve longer drain oil intervals with these engines. And currently now they're working on PC12, which again, another common theme is how can we improve the oxidation control of the oil and viscosity control. Those are two big things. So really when you look at it today, and how does that aftertreatment system trying to control what's coming out of the exhaust impact the oil formulation, it's been like a massive jump, paradigm shift in how we formulate oils today, because we're not just looking at the engine, which, you know, I've been in this business for 35 years. I mean, when I came in, it was CF.
A long way.
And now it's not just formulating for the engine, it's formulating for the engine plus the aftertreatment system. So what new things can we do? What novel technology can we put into the engine oils that will benefit not only the engine, durability, oil drain intervals, but also protect and maybe help the after treatment system by not poisoning the catalyst or extending DPF life, if you will.
The next question I have for you, and you've actually mentioned it a couple times, the key term here is ash. And up until as recently as last week, I was always kind of under this impression that ash was the industry technical term for soot. But I was recently told that is not the case at all. So can you kind of give us the difference between soot and ash and why a low ash formula is so important for these after treatment systems?
When we're talking about soot, you're really talking about unburned fuel. And it's really a function of how you're operating the equipment, the load conditions, and quite honestly, the fuel that you're using. There's been a lot of discussion, Bryan, in the industry about renewable diesels or biodiesels versus petroleum diesel, and what's the difference? And you know, there's been some claims, but I mean, the fact is a renewable diesel has a much higher cetane number. So, you know, you're looking at maybe around 65, 70 versus petroleum diesel, which is right around 45, let's say, or 50. So renewable diesel burns cleaner, produces less soot, but it's really a fraction of a percentage of what's produced in diesel, and especially for the off-road market. So soot is that unburned fuel that goes into the exhaust stream, and you got to do something with it, right? So sometimes people will say, oh my gosh, my DPFs look horrible. Look at all this black stuff that's on it. Well, that's just soot.
You know, and that is, just to clarify, that is what is burning off when we do a regeneration cycle, correct?
100%. It's totally consumable, and it's repetitively generated and what have you. Ash is a different animal. So ash is really metals. And predominantly the source, we've done analysis. There's been many SAE papers that have done analysis as well. About 90% of that ash is coming from the engine oil formulation.
Wow.
So this is your zincs, your phosphorus, your calcium, magnesiums, things like that. The other 10% is wear metals. It may be contaminants coming in from the atmosphere, things like that, and maybe some fuel contaminants as well. But the overriding percentage of ash that collects in that DPF is from the lubricant. And just to clarify, like you were talking about, when you do a regen, the soot gets consumed, it gets burned, and that's where you're having 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, 1,100 degrees, and it, you know, these channels are so small, but it's like this fire force that's going on in the DPF. It's crazy, right? You know, if it works well, then all the soot gets consumed. Any oil, petroleum products that are gets burned, but what's left is the ash components from the oil, and that's what collects in the channels, and that's why people need to clean the DPF, because you can't burn those things. They're just going to collect in the channels and fill up, and so it's looking at the oil, and there's a 1% sulfated ash minimum today. It has been for API CJ4. It's been there for CK4. I don't know what it's going to end up being for PC12. It may be 1%. It may be less. But ash is the limiting factor on your service life at the DPF. And, you know, back in, I guess it was 2019, Chevron launched our Delo 600 ADF. We took a challenge over a decade ago of looking at the oils and working with OEMs to see, can you just eliminate the ash? Because if you can eliminate the ash, I don't ever have to clean that DPF.
Yeah, there's no problem now.
Yeah, and we tried, but you have to, no ash is okay for the after treatment system, but you've got to have something for the engine. So it's a combination of engine durability, protection, performance, oil drain interval, plus after treatment system. And that's where we kind of settled on this 0.4%. So you reduce the ash by 2.5 times. And then the obvious one is, well, now I can extend my DPF service life 2.5 times.
And that's a substantial savings to a contractor.
Oh, it's big. And you know, again, it's, you know, I often talk with a lot of people, and sometimes we'll talk on highway, sometimes we'll talk off highway. But, you know, I hate to say it, but, you know, off highway gets the short end on DPF service. I mean, you know, for trucks, it's really easy, right? I'm going to pull into a dealer network, boom, pop that thing out and go. I've seen these DPF changeouts on loaders, excavators, you name it. You're talking 4 to 8 hours.
Yeah.
And because that's so hot, you know, I mean, the proper practice is do a regeneration before you do it to clean off all the soot and get all that done. Yeah, okay, great. Now you just heated it up to 1,000 degrees. Now I want you to go sit and see how long that takes to cool off.
Yeah, absolutely. Try to get some wrenches on that baby.
Exactly. It becomes a safety issue. And sure. You know, you can always say, well, don't do that. Just disconnect it, right? Well, okay, fine. But now your mechanics are breathing in all these soot particles. I mean, that's not right. So, you know, it takes time and the downtime, and you can't just do this out in the field. You got to bring it in. So it's, again, you know, for off-highway presents a lot of challenges that you don't see in on-highway.
Absolutely. And just for the viewers, I do want to restate the key takeaway there. And this is what really blew my mind last week when I put all this together, is that the reason we're having to do DPF maintenance has nothing to do, there's a small component, but really nothing to do with the diesel particulate itself. It's actually the ash, which is a direct result of the engine oil, which is why this conversation is such a big deal. And I had just never put those two dots together.
Right. And we can say newer engines are tight, they consume less oil, but it's impossible to eliminate that waste oil stream, right? And, you know, this is used oil that's going out in the exhaust stream. It's carrying, you know, whatever used metals it's got. It's carrying the additive system. It's carrying all of this out. And it's difficult to control under the best of circumstances. But, you know, if you look at things that control high oil consumption, well, a lot of off-highway customers are idling 25-30% of the time, heavy PTO usage. That, you know, the engine doesn't get hot enough, rings don't seat properly, you start consuming more oil, and that starts to shorten DPF life. And, you know, we've dealt with a lot of customers, and what they'll say is, well, wait, you know, the OEM may say 4,500 hours or 5,000 hours for my DPF service. I'm getting three. Why is that?
Yeah.
Well, you know, heavy loads, you're consuming more oil. Idling, you're consuming more oil. And this is where the oil choice goes in, and the oxidation control is, you know, not all oils are equal. I mean, the specifications are, here's the minimum you need to achieve the specification. It doesn't differentiate all API CK4 oils. They don't all perform the same. So if you have an oil that creates more deposits, if you're at the wrong oil drain interval, well, those deposits start to build up. The rings don't seal again properly. You start to increase some liner wear. And again, your oil consumption goes up. And controlling that oil consumption is important. But there's only so much you can do. So that's why Chevron was looking at saying, well, let's control the ash content. That's something, you know, that we can control and that's real and that we can see. And so it really is about that, right?
You kind of actually led me right into it and kind of answered my next question, which is, you know, idle time is one of the biggest culprits to after treatment systems in our industry. Outside of the obvious of just reducing the ash that is generated, can oil formulations help with that increased maintenance due to increased idle time?
Yeah, I mean, you know, a short answer is yeah, they can, right? And we kind of talked a little bit about it, and part of the other negative on these high idles, and look, I get it, you know, people in cold weather, maybe that unit's idling like 24 hours. You know, maybe it's not idling like 40-50% of the time, right? Guy who needs to keep warm, we all get that. But, you know, during that idle time, you're also not generating enough heat in that engine to operate it efficiently. So there's a couple of things that happen, right? Well, you increase the soot generation. And so that oil, while we don't think about it, that oil has to be able to disperse that soot. I mean, that's a big issue, right? Having something that can handle and disperse those soot particles better is a big thing, right? Viscosity control and all that. The other thing is proper sealing. We talked about it, where resisting the deposit and varnish deposits around those piston rings and componentry in the engine will really help to minimize the oil that is getting out there.
Yeah.
You know, I think this is a big decision that some fleets work with is, you know, do I go 10W30? Do I go 1540? 10W30 from a durability performance, everything works perfectly well in most off-highway equipment. Will people see a fuel economy benefit? I don't know. But, you know, one thing you have to watch for is viscosity, shear down. If the oil gets too thin, again, increase oil consumption.
You lose all your protection at that point.
And you lose your protection. Now you've increased wear, and as the wear rates go up, now you don't get the proper sealing. So it really is about protecting and doing the basics on the engine for more severe, if you will, handling more soot, and being able not to pump as much ash as you will. And if I could just say, Bryan, you clean your DPF out, you get the ash out. The reason you do that is, you know, as that ash builds up into the channel, you're effectively reducing the size of the DPF.
Sure.
The soot can't get past the ash. I mean, the soot's got nowhere to go. So regen cycles start to happen more frequently.
You've basically taken a 10-lane highway and reduced it down to 4 lanes.
Exactly. Exactly. This is why, you know, everything may be great when you start off. Hey, I've got this and you don't see any problems. And then after 1,000 hours, you're like, whoa, I'm getting more frequent requests or lights on to go do my regen. And depending on your idle conditions and things like that, this can start to really accelerate. You know, the oil's got to be able to do the protection, got to control the oil consumption. And really the best thing is to control that ash that's going in.
You know, you do make a key point. One of the things that I've always thought is when we're talking 2-5% fuel savings for on-road trucks because you switch to a low viscosity oil, for off-highway equipment, that's never going to be a measurable number because we have so many site conditions that play into it that if it rains tomorrow, all of a sudden my fuel economy tanks because I'm in mud as opposed to dry hard-packed clay. But one thing that does stick out to me is as those regeneration cycles continue to get more and more and more frequent, on top of the fact that you've just become more and more restricted on your exhaust output, that's materially going to have an impact that's very noticeable on, you know, off-highway piece of equipment. So it does have an impact. It's just not in the same way that you would see in the on-road environment.
Correct. It's not as clean. I mean, we can see it in, let's say, vocational trucks, you know, dump trucks or things that are running on a certain road ready mix, things like that. You'll see the fuel consumption increase over the life of the DPF.
Interesting.
It will definitely increase. It's going to be difficult to prove that on, let's say, an excavator.
Just way too many variables and site conditions play into it.
Way too many. And, you know, we talk to customers and it really gets back to what we started talking about earlier. It's a number of regens. When you see these regen frequencies start to increase and, you know, people can see that in their telematics data, their operators know it, right? Now you're starting to see the impact. And yeah, okay, maybe you're using 1 or 2 gallons per regeneration or so, depending on the size of the engine. And that may be insignificant in all the fuel burn they're doing. But you're starting to get to back pressure issues. You're starting to get to downtime issues. And I think one of the challenges that operators have is they don't want to stop to do that regeneration, right? You know, we talked about the engine temperatures being so important to the aftertreatment system. And, you know, if you're idling a lot and just calling for a regeneration and the operator keeps, you know, running through the lights of no, not going to do it, you know, eventually it catches up. But by then, we've got all these other issues happening, right? Because think about the soot as it builds up in that DPF. A lot of times that soot, if it gets too much and they keep bypassing, that soot's going to go back, force it back into the engine, and you're going to start to see turbo issues. You may see a lot of soot or looks like black goo or something like that collecting around the turbo, probably because of that. They just haven't been doing the regens. And regens, most OEMs will set it in the off-highway market to trigger every 24 hours, 25 hours. It's just going to do it no matter what. And it's not just for the DPF. It's not just for burning out the soot. That whole regeneration process cleans out the diesel oxidation catalyst and the SCR. So it desulfonates it, right? So it's beneficial for everything. So the more you bypass it, the more damage you do, not just to the DPF, but potentially to the whole system.
Interesting. So that's another perfect lead into my last question here, which is the two big ones that we think of in the off-road market when it comes to aftertreatment packages are DPFs. And then it's alternative in a lot of times is the SCR. Do we need a separate oil formulation for those, or is it something where that low ash is going to benefit both of those systems, regardless of if you have both DPF and SCR?
But before we get into that, I want to take a second to tell you about the sponsor of this video, Chevron Lubricants. Protecting your diesel engine and its exhaust aftertreatment system has traditionally been seen as an either-or proposition when it comes to choosing the engine oil that's going to protect your system. And that's exactly why Chevron spent more than a decade of R&D work developing a no-compromise formulation. Now, I don't have to tell you why a clogged DPF is bad news, but here's the real kick in the pants. 90% of that ash clogging up your DPF and then upping your fuel and maintenance costs, it comes from your engine oil. You might be thinking, why don't they make an engine oil with less ash in it then? You'll be happy to learn that Chevron agrees with you. They've developed a new ultra-low ash diesel engine oil that is specifically designed to combat DPF ash clogging. Delo 600 ADF with OmniMax technology cuts sulfate ash by 60%, radically reducing the rate of DPF clogging and extending the DPF service life by 2.5 times. Before, you had to choose between protecting your engine or your aftertreatment system. Now you don't. Delo 600 ADF with OmniMax technology. It's time to kick some ash.
It's a tricky one. So you can obviously use the same oil. You can use the same oil we do it today. And OEMs have took different approaches to Tier 4 final emission requirements. Some were able to do it with SCR only. Some took it on with the DPF, you know, DOC, DPF, SCR. One thing I would mention before we get a little bit more into the question is that we've seen a couple of things happening over the last few years. Europe moved into stage 5 into 2019, and while North America may not really care about that, it does have an impact because stage 5 in Europe clearly dictated a DPF is required, period. They don't care what you did with the stage 4, it's you will use a DPF, and they really brought the horsepower down to like 48 horsepower requirement, right? The other thing that's going on is the California Air Resources Board, CARB. They're working on now their Tier 5 emission standards. So
and we're all very excited about that, by the way.
Yeah. And so, you know, that Tier 5 is really looking to reduce NOx and PM emissions by like 90%, 50 to 90% over, you know, by 2030 or so. But the main point is going to be it's going to require a DPF, and it's going to require you eliminating previous older technology, so the Tier 3s, right? So you know, the CARB's been very good about limiting and working on people to get more and more Tier 4 finals into their fleets. This is just going to accelerate that. So for people that think DPFs are going to go away, not going to happen. Matter of fact, you're going to see an increased usage. That being said, SCRs are still going to be there because we've got to get rid of the NOx. And so while we talk a lot about ash being a limiting factor for the DPF service life, actually phosphorus is limiting for the SCR. Phosphorus is poisonous to the SCR, so it will deactivate the catalyst. Sulfur content can poison DOC, which is the oxidation catalyst, which is right before the DPF, can poison that catalyst. So the sulfur is not such a big deal because when you do the regens and you get the temperatures, it takes care of that. But the phosphorus is irreversible. And so, you know, oils high in FOS, not so good on SCR. And I know some off-highway OEMs that we're working with are looking actually at putting a second SCR system up front.
Oh, man. So,
if you can imagine that, you know, the aftertreatment system today, and I should have said this earlier, right, to put it in perspective, it's about 40 to 50% the footprint of an engine.
Yeah, you can see it on the back of most machines. It's this huge package on top of the actual engine itself.
On top of it. And, you know, I was at one OEM and we were looking at some stationary engines, and it was for agriculture pumping units and what have you. So, I mean, they're like, you know, 4-6 liter engines, something like that. And the aftertreatment system was on top of it. It was actually bigger than the engine. And the cost is approaching this. And I'm not trying to be an alarmist. I'm just saying this is the reality, right? I've been talking about this for over a year, is that DPFs, DOCs, have a lot of precious metals in them, right? Particularly platinum and palladium. One thing that Stage 5 is doing in Europe requiring DPFs is, well, the demand for DPFs is going up because they've got to fill that Europe market. There's only so many OEMs, right? There's only so much precious metals. The other thing is, You know, China and India, well, China is a little bit more further ahead. They've already gone to what would be the equivalent to Euro 6 on highway in 2019. This year in December, they're launching basically their tier 4 final for off highway. Now, China manufactures 1 million trucks a year. So think about the number of DPFs. Now, look at the off-highway equipment that is going to be consumed. And India is right behind them. So, you know, I've talked to customers again in our reliability maintenance conferences earlier this year, and DPFs are getting scarce and they're going to get more expensive. And I'm telling you, and I sound like the arbiter of bad news, but I mean, yeah, people need to figure out how to get their hands around managing this program before it manages them. And I'm not disparaging the DPF cleaning facilities and things like this, but it's just a fact. A new DPF is much better than a clean DPF. You can't get all the ash out. You can't get all of it out. And you're going to leave so much behind. Well, you know, what if it's been cleaned twice?
You kind of have diminishing returns every time you do it.
Exactly. And my recommendation would be, right, is that people need to think about what's their strategy, what's their program, how are they doing this. You know, sometimes we go into fleets and on off highway and we'll be asking, well, where's your records? How often are you doing this? And not disparaging them, but it's like, maybe they don't know, right? And they start looking at this and they're saying, whoa, 2,500 hours, 3,000, what's going on? Maybe they're not getting a properly cleaned or a fully cleaned DPF. But if you look at the new DPFs, they're all spot on, 5,000 hours, 5,000 hours, 5,000, you know. But that's a recommendation, is get a handle on it, track it, see where you are. The other, and if I can, Bryan, just pass on some maybe a best practice and working with some OEMs and looking at some customers that they have. And it was very interesting that one of the things they showed me, and this was at a cement plant, they had a whole bunch that they were working with and same company, same equipment, same, you know, operation type thing. And one operation, the mechanic there figured out that every morning before everyone got there, before everyone started taking the equipment and doing their thing, he did regenerations on the equipment, just set them all up and just boom, 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 boom. And when we looked at the charts, right, the back pressure charts, the regeneration frequencies, the fuel efficiencies and economy, it was almost what you would expect. It was like just perfect graphs. But the other sites allowed the operators to do it. You could see they were never getting the life of the DPF. They were always like changing about 3,000 and they were over. So, you know, little things like being proactive, making sure that DEF, a lot of people don't realize, you know, the diesel exhaust fluid got to be kept clean. You can't contaminate it with water or whatever. Sometimes just dialing it back and going back to basics, keeping things clean, maybe being proactive on some of these force regens and get it out there and get it done before everyone takes it out or do it when the equipment comes back, can pay dividends down the road.
I will say it does occur to me, and it's become even more apparent through this conversation, which, by the way, this has been fantastic. For off-highway equipment, there's a real lack of education on not only after treatment systems themselves, but then proper care of those after treatment systems. And then the third stage is when it comes to the actual education of how big of an impact the engine oil has, I don't think that information's really making it to the end user like it needs to be. I mean, like I said, I've been in this industry for 12 years now, and it wasn't until last week that really it finally clicked in that, oh wow, all of this DPF maintenance isn't the result of just burning fuel, it's actually the engine oil itself. Well, now I understand why these low ash formulations are so critical. And now you've even taken it a step further. If we really are in looking down the barrel of a DPF shortage, well, materially increasing my DPF life by 2.5 times, that's no little thing to shrug at. That's a substantial lifetime investment over the piece of the equipment in my overall business. And I just don't think that education is really getting to the end user like it needs to.
And I think that's something that, you know, now's, I say like now's the time, but I think now's the time for everyone to be really thinking about this, because it's going to take a while to get these programs in place. The other thing that, you know, I've heard, Bryan, for the last few years across the globe, I don't care where I am, Japan, China, Europe, where, it doesn't matter. It's manpower shortages and quality mechanics, right? And if you've got a fleet and your mechanic's spending all day changing out a DPF and that's all he's doing, to me, that's a real wasted opportunity. right? And a lot of times, especially on the bigger equipment, it's not one guy, it's two guys. One guy can't man, you know, you can't handle these things.
These are big units, especially on a lot of these loaders and excavators. These are not little muffler size things. These are huge units and they're heavy.
Correct. And in some units, even if you're looking at like 22 liter or 30 liter engine and above, they may have two, right? If it's a V set, they'll have two DPFs. So, you know, it's where do you want your time spent? And to me, it's changing out the DPF filter and sending it off to get it clean, waiting for it to come back, or, you know, worse, doing a swap out and you don't know where it's from and you've got one of your mechanics spending a day and a half on this. If you can avoid that.
Yeah, you know, that's huge.
And this is what I hear a lot, is it's an unexpected PM. Because they don't always happen at 4,500 hours or 5,000 hours. In these cases that we work with customers, 3,000, 3,200 hours. I mean, they have to do it. So it's unplanned versus, well, you know what? Maybe I don't do 12,000 hours or so. Maybe I do it over the winter when the equipment's down and, you know, I don't have to worry about it. You know, you're never going to get that alarm or derate when you're not doing anything. It's always going to come when you...
Right in the middle of the busiest part of the job, right at the crossroads of everything.
Exactly. Or, you know, with ready mix, you know, we talk about that and with some of those customers, and it's like, yeah, the guy has to do a regen. Well, if he's got a load, you know, it takes like 40 minutes.
Yeah. Yep. Everybody, the whole job, just kick back and take a break because I got to do a regen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Of course, I'm in the lubricants business, so I would say this, but it's not just about getting the lowest cost thing in there, right? And the right, you've really got to look at your total cost of operation, and you really got to think this through and look at not just the engine durability, the oil drain intervals that you want to get. I think that there's opportunities there for customers to advance and work this out. But then look at your DPF maintenance and your SCR, you know, investments and such, and really look at and say, where's it costing me? And when you start looking at labor costs, downtime and everything else, those are the big chunks that we're all going to have to really address in this labor market competitiveness that we're going to be in as we see the economy in the next couple of years. So it's, you know, that's where I think they need to think. Just have a paradigm shift in their thinking on how to do maintenance. Not just thinking about the engine, but what can I do proactively? Because I just feel that a lot of customers feel that the after treatment system is out of control, right? It's like this black box that it goes wrong and everyone hits the equipment and, you know, yells at the dealer or something. But no, let's look at the black box. Let's see what's inside it. Let's understand it and understand the choices that you make on your engine oil, what you're doing on your preventive maintenance program, impact that, and you can control it. It's not uncontrollable.
I think you just made a great point that really would resonate with the off-road market specifically. The mechanic shortage is a great example. So you only have so many mechanics, and everyone in the dirt industry knows that your mechanics are, they're never bored. They are constantly five pieces of equipment behind at any given time. And so now you're going to take one of those mechanics in the height of the season when you've got three additional machines down, which means you have lost production. But now he's got to go take that 4 hours to go remove this DPF so that they can either send it off to be cleaned or you have to actually replace the DPF. You don't just have the cost of the mechanic's time there. You've got the cost of all of those idle machines while he's messing with this one. Yet if you can extend the DPF by 2.5 times, you start pushing that out to that 12,000 hour mark. Well, now all of a sudden, you've taken all of that expense off of your books, because I would say the vast majority of contractors are rotating their equipment by the 10,000 hour mark. And so you've taken all of the cost associated with that and totally removed it from your books. And the only thing you changed was your oil formulation. I think that's really the sort of education that's not making it to the front lines of, this is a material impact to your bottom line. And it's not just, oh, it's going to save you one DPF cleaning. It's the whole picture.
I can't speak, you know, the mechanics I've talked to have said it's one of the worst jobs they do.
Sure. So, absolutely.
You know, nobody likes to do it. And we all know that, you know, when you don't like to do a job and it's like that, it's like, you know, how much effort you
absolutely. You're going to move at half speed, so it takes you even longer.
quite honestly, it's not what they want to do. They want to fix something, right? And they love the engine and fixing problems and jumping on stuff, whether it's hydraulic systems or whatever. But yeah, go change that DPF. Oh man, I shot my whole day. And you know it's going to be a hassle because you got to take everything off and put it all back together. I mean, it's just no fun. So I think if we can get that going, I think it's all about making the most out of your resources that you possibly can. And what can you take off the plate? I think everybody asks themselves that. And if you can take these things off your plate and I cycle my equipment out at 10,000 hours, I'm done.
Absolutely. That's huge. Well, Keith, thank you for this discussion. This has been super educational on so many levels. I really do appreciate the conversation.
Oh, no problem. Thank you, Bryan. I appreciate it.
Well, thanks for sticking around to the end of this one. Like I said, that was a lot to digest. It was a lot to take in. But this has totally shifted the way I look at aftertreatment systems, the way that I understand them. And I had no idea engine oil was the number one culprit for all of our aftertreatment system maintenance that we have to do. That was a real eye-opener. So as always, I hope this has been helpful. We'll catch you guys on the next episode of The Dirt.